But it so happens that this is not as effective as I had imagined because of so many constraints which you would see. So this particular experience report is just going to be about what did I do with some of my teams, and I'm going to share it with you guys. I'm going to quickly tell what I have done. I'm just going to open it for questions. If you have any questions, we can just ask me those questions, specific ones, and then we can wrap it up. So that is going to be the agenda for the day. So let's start with the first one. So as the title goes, to pair or not to pair. So if you see, one of the few challenges that most of the non-technical coaches face in their agile journey is, of course, we all start with Scrum. Of course, we all start with Kanban and so many ceremonies, so many things to talk about. I'm sure most of you would have understood by now that most of the teams are very quick at getting these jargons, they have become very fluent in their jargons very quickly. It doesn't take them so much time to understand what a DSM means, what a retrospective is. But of course, effectiveness is questionable. But nevertheless, most of the teams, what they do is they just start with something and then they finally feel that, OK, they've done something and they just stop there. But we also know that in the process, if the teams have to get to a stage, that's why I've used the word commendable agile fluency, by which what I mean is if they have to reach a stage where they are actually agile, where they reach their, go beyond their barriers and boundaries, management practices alone is not enough. So you guys agree with me, all of you, all right? So the next one is, if you see, technical practices are definitely very important, but we also know that it's the most difficult thing to implement because of some of the constraints that we have in the organization. And one of the biggest constraints we have is most organizations have a lot of budget reductions in terms of how many coaches they can actually have, because when it comes to technical coaching, there are a lot of hands-on experience is required by the coach, and they have to practically sit with the agilist and the team members to get it done. So this is also a challenge. And what is the last challenge? I mean, this is something which I've noticed. I just feel that the practices are the most toughest thing to change, just because I think the engineers are very personal about it. Unlike your management practices, when you talk about a meeting, when you just tell them, okay, you can change this meeting this way, do this, do that, they just go ahead and do it. But when you talk about practices, it's almost like the bread and butter. It's like, I mean, I've always seen team members being very sentimental about it because that's the way they know coding and that's the way they know testing. And anyone who comes and questions it, it's like not happening because that is like challenging their status quo, which obviously means that the pain factor is also going to be more. So these are the challenges that I have personally faced when I have to coach my teams. So I'm sure some of you would relate to it as well. So quick show of hands. Do you have the same problems or do you have a different set of issues? All right, cool then. Some of you have the same problem. So what do you think of the metaphor? Why do you think I've chosen wine and cheese? Why do you think it's wine and cheese? They pair well. They pair well? Okay, all right. So what happens if I'm going to pair differently? If I'm going to have a different cheese and a different wine, will that not work well? It won't taste better? All right, okay. Let's see. So now, where do we start? So where do we start? So one of the things that I'm going to propose, or what I have been doing with my teams, I just call it as non-homogeneous pairing, by which what I mean is I'm not necessarily looking at pairing team members who are technical, like say the ones who are writing code or the ones who writes test cases or ones who is involved in the product development, but also involve people other than these guys in the team, like meaning the other stakeholders in this team. So in my case, I started pairing with my team members, meaning I start pairing with my developers, I start pairing with my testers, we'll see how I was going about it. But the whole idea is non-homogeneous pairing. So if I have to elaborate a bit about what non-homogeneous pairing is, like say obviously as the name goes, it's going to be non-homogeneous, which means I'm going to bring in people with two different sets and two different skill sets. I'm going to put them together and I'm going to ask them, okay, how it's going to work for you now. So now this is your task and what are the things that you're noticing. So the second one is it's going to be very strategic because it's not going to be like very goal oriented, meaning it is not like you have one single goal and you guys work towards it. You guys strategize it in such a way that this experiment is successful. And that goes with the next word, which is experimental, by which what I mean is it's okay to have wrong cheese with a different wine. Meaning what I'm trying to say is don't be very cynical or don't get into this smell, which is analysis paralysis. Don't be very specific about matching the right components because you never know. Because agile is all about doing, just give it a shot and then see how it goes. It might work or it may not work. No harm in it. So that's why I'm going to call it as experimental. As always, it's going to be time box because you don't have the luxury of time. You cannot do things forever. You have to time box it and see, have some specific idea in mind and see what are you going to derive out of it? Having said that, when I say idea, the idea here is to see what the team members are going. You know, so don't have any preconceived notions about this is how it has to be. Be a little bit open to what is happening with the team members. And the fourth one, promiscuous. As with any pairing technique, it's always advisable to be promiscuous, at least when it comes to pairing. I'm not endorsing this for real life, but in pairing, yes, it's fine. So in the last one, what is very important is executed with awareness. Any idea what it means? What do I have to say with this? What do I mean by executed with awareness? Anybody? Anyone? Very conscious about it. You know, when you're, especially when you're a coach, I'm assuming that most of you have an ability to understand what the other person is thinking. Or rather, I'm not saying you're going to judge the person, but you're a little bit empathetic towards what is happening in the situation. So do things with awareness. Don't get carried away by what is happening in the sessions. So I'll share some of my experiences, like how team members might react to such a proposal at the end. But as of now, you can just remember, be a little bit aware, you know, just be aware of yourself, see what is happening, understand your process, and see what is happening to you internally so that you can actually be with a team member and then start this exercise. So why are we doing this? You know, like I said, one of the challenges that I've gone, some few of the challenges that I've already mentioned, but one of the biggest starting block that I had was that a lot of inhibitions about starting something new. So instead of letting a team member figure it out themselves, I started doing it myself. You know, I started getting into the floor, you know, started embedding myself with the team. Of course, I'm not developing the product with them, but I start becoming part of their process, which means if I'm going to work with a team, if I'm going to coach with a team, it means that I'm going to be with them throughout the day. It's not like I just attend their meetings and then I just walk out. So day in and day out, the entire day I'll be with the team with different people, and then it's a very good experience. I really, really enjoyed it. I'll be just talking about the benefits. So this is what I'm going to talk about. So the whole idea is about non-homogeneous pairing. So I was just going to quickly elaborate about what all things that you have to remember when you are getting into an engagement like this, and what are the benefits. I'm going to tell you a few tools that I use as an intervention, also for some of the other practices. That is up to you guys to go and research on that. All right? So any questions on this? Any questions on non-homogeneous pairing or until now, or else I'll just move on? Nothing? All right, cool then. So I thought I'd just quickly give an intro about myself. So I just call myself as a greedy soul because I'm very, very greedy. So my name is Karthikamal Balasubramaniam, and I work for Agile FAQs as one of the consulting coaches. And my name is really, really long. It's like very long, so people call me KK. So you can just call me KK, and it's very easy for everyone. So the whole journey for Agile has been like very self-driven. And I've been a developer, and I've also been practicing psychotherapy for some time now. So I hope I just get better at it eventually. So this is my quick background. So now talking about what is this right approach to pairing? Although I was not very sure about using this word right, because I just believe that there's nothing called as the right approach. You guys have to just go ahead, just do it, and see how it works for you. Quickly get a feedback, recalibrate. You know, that's exactly what it is. But since I have to say something, I'm just using right approach as a word, but there's nothing called as a right approach. So a few things that I do with my team is, so the first point, which is like make a contract. So this is something I do with all my teams, irrespective of whatever I'm doing. So you understand what a contract is? Any idea? Someone? You know what a contract is? Set of agreements, okay, cool, okay. What kind of agreements? Like say, we had agreed to meet for this session at 2:30, and then I say, this is the topic, these are the slides, this is the speaker, and you have all the logistics set. What are the other kind of agreements that you guys have here? So, sorry? Violations like? That will be also, that's more like a working agreement, right? Okay, cool. All that is true. But what I would like to really emphasize here is, so contracts has been a very favorite topic for me because I've seen that being as a solution for most of the problems that I've had with my Agile teams. I think I presented about contracts in multiple other sessions as well. To give you a quick intro about what each of these means, like the admin contract, professional contract, and the psychological contract. So admin contract is generally all the logistics. So when I go and decide to pair with a team member, I just talk to the team member and the team asking, okay, this is what I'm proposing. So can I come at so-and-so time? What will you be doing at that time? Or is it okay if I just come and pair with you and see what is happening? So that is my administrative contract, all right? So meaning I'm just fixing the time, I'm just fixing the location, what we're going to do. And now comes a professional contract. So what I mean by a professional contract is, so in this particular room, there is a contract that we already have, meaning, for instance, when I started the session, I just asked you guys, so this is what I'm planning to propose. Do you guys have any disagreements? Right? I'm just making a contract with you guys just to make sure, okay, we are all on the same page. So you guys have an option to walk out if this is not something that you've signed up for. Right? So that is a professional contract. So, and the last one is psychological contract, meaning, to give it very shortly, professional contracts are very role-related. So there are always role-specific things that you have to do. Because you are a manager, you have to ensure the employee doesn't leave the organization. Right? So that is almost always understood that attrition is always because of the manager, things like that. And what is psychological contract? So often I see that the admin and the professional contracts are very well carried out in most organizations, I would say in most of the teams, but psychological contract, not really. So when we say a particular person has to do it, and if it's a compulsion, then there is a problem there. So psychological contract is where I ask them, you know, are you really okay to do this? If you're not okay, what are the problems you have? So basically I engage in a conversation, so that kind of brings out the ulterior out and open. So it's a lot more easier for me to carry on with the session, so I'm not forcing anyone to do this. Because if you see, the problem with most practice adoptions is most of the team members are being forced to do something because that's an organization norm. Especially in services industry, it's because the customer wants it, they almost always go ahead with it. But even in such circumstances, I would strongly recommend contract, not just in this pairing situation, be it anything, apply it and I think it will make wonders to your team. All right. So that's going to be the very first step. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a contract with the team at all three levels. Basically, I get a consensus from them saying, hey guys, this is what I'm planning to do. Are you okay with it? Right? Now comes the second point. So like with the other pairing, I mean, I'm going to take up the navigator role alone, which means I'm not going to write code. I'm not going to do the actual work itself, but I'm going to observe what they're going to do. So here it is very, very important. So just imagine me sitting next to you and watching you all the while, how it's going to be. Will you be comfortable with it? No? All right, why? Absolutely. So why does that happen? And why does that happen? Because you're afraid of making mistakes, which means there is some fear. There is some fear of punishment. And also there is a fear of being judged, you know, to see, okay, what am I doing? Am I good, bad, or like, especially when it comes to programming, people do have a lot of things about that. So especially when you're doing this, be very, very careful. That's where I have some more sensitive items as well, which we'll come back. But as of now, you know, if you have to be a navigator, just observe what the team members are doing and then make notes, you know, meaning don't threaten them, but make notes, make a mental note in terms of, okay, this is what is happening. Basically be open. Don't have any preconceived notions about this is how it has to be. You know, maybe one, we can take some simple philosophies, that's what I mean by focus on the big picture. Just focus on the high level principles, but never get into the nitty gritties of how it has to be done. Just understand that, okay, it has, let's say, for example, if you understand that code smell should not be there, don't tell them this is how it has to be there. If someone is writing a piece of code, see what they are doing and give them a chance to explain, that goes a long way. So, first 3 points, contract, and then be a navigator, and ask. Ask is also very important, because sometimes, ask coaches, when I say, well, why I want to emphasize on this ask part is, when I say asking, it means a conversation as well. It is not always about, yes. No, what I'm saying is, like, basically observe, you know, collect as many things as possible and be watchful of what is happening. Don't lose some tiny details. I'll be just giving you some examples on that, maybe that would help. So ask, what I mean by ask is have a conversation, you know, try to engage in a conversation so that there is a lot more give and take and it's not like one-sided. And be very, very careful, don't make it as an audit exercise. Okay, this is something people have to be very watchful of because most of them are like very scared of such instances, so don't make that. So the third one is, like I said, focus on the big picture. It's gonna be lean, experience, systems thinking, or whatever principles apply to you. And the fourth one is be confident, and don't be overconfident or cocky because it's gonna really put them off. And the last one is be inclusive, sensitive, and non-scary. So I think the non-scary part is very important. You know, just try to be inclusive, and you have to experiment it. You have to see, start pairing with your team members, and you will understand what I exactly mean. But as of now, few basic approaches for pairing would be this. So any questions on this? Anyway, I'll come back to making notes part again, but any other questions, or I'll just move on to the next slide. You guys are clear? All right. Now, talking about, so since I said it's going to be a wine and cheese example, we have been talking about pairing the right kind of wine with the right kind of cheese. So it also means that you're going to pair with different kind of people, and all the cheeses are not the same. So if you want the best taste, one of the things that you guys could do, I'm just assuming that since you are coaches, you have some experience in life coaching, and you have some experience with people, handling people and all that, since you're doing it with awareness, I'm just putting it with some caution, I'm just saying that be the right wine for your cheese. You know, try to modify certain attributes about yourself. That's what I meant when I mean by execute it with awareness, because see what is happening, see what the other person's requirements are. Don't jump into conclusion with a template, because that is going to sabotage the exercise. All right? And why this is very important, any idea why? Because the whole reason for doing this is to start something, right? We want the technical practices to start, and I'm starting with pairing. But what will happen if you're going to sabotage this with these notions? It's going to be very difficult to start these technical practices again in the team, because the teams are already scared. It's almost like once bitten, twice shy. So be very, very watchful. So in the process of getting somewhere, don't ruin it for yourself. Just be a little careful about what you're doing, because it's really, really threatening to sit next to a team member and see what they are doing. So make sure you're friendly, make sure you really understand what they are doing, and be non-judgmental. I think that would really go a long way. Another aspect is, so this is also something I've realized in the journey, because initially when I started, I just paired only with the developers, you know, because I was just thinking, okay, this is what I have to do. So let's see what they are doing. Because the primary goal or the objective was to see how are they coding, you know, what is happening with the code, what are the code smells we have, what kind of issues they have. I mean, obviously, if you see, you will see multiple issues, like say, the number of copy-paste in the code that you see is like unimaginable. And I've seen people, I mean, I'll be sitting next to them whenever there is a bug. Most of the time, at least 80% of the times, I would say, most of the developers, they do copy-paste. And we all know that the moment you copy-paste something, it's a smell. It's a repeatability smell, but very rarely people do refactor. So things like this does happen, but be very watchful of that and see how you can correct them very positively, with very positive feedback. But eventually, what I've realized is not pairing with developers alone is useful. You might have to just start pairing with different people. Because in the entire value stream, it is not just the developers who is going to be involved in the product development. There are other stakeholders as well, like your technical writers, sometimes your architects, and even managers. If you could pair with them for some of the practices, I think it goes a long way. Just sit with them and see what is happening, and then do it as a team, and you will have a lot of insights. So any questions on this? All right, so I've kind of covered what non-homogeneous pairing is and what are the approaches, what are things that I recommend, and I've also covered what all kind of pairing that you can do. So now coming back to a few examples that I have seen. So recently I was doing this exercise with one of the testers. I'm just giving an example that comes to my mind. So I was just doing this exercise with one of the testers. I was just sitting next to him. I was just developing a piece of code. I mean, he was just testing, and I was just watching what they were doing. So what I've realized is there were some of the cases. See, I'm a layman, so I would assume that my understanding of the product is only limited, because I've just started working with the team for a month, and they would know better. But when I started looking at certain things, there are certain expectations that the end users will have. Right? So when I started asking those questions to the tester, I just realized that all the while they have been looking at what the developers have given, and they've hardly thought through it, meaning they've thought beyond it. So there was a limitation, and when I asked those questions, then that initiated the conversation. Then when we did understand, okay, where it went wrong, it all went back to the requirement gathering part, wherein how did they even did the user story splitting. So the testers were not even involved in the user story splitting. So if I had ideally asked them, you know, in a very common room, if I just pull them in and I ask, okay, what are the problems in your team, often I will not get these details. But when you actually sit with them and see what is happening, you will notice that there are so many organizational impediments like this, which is really, really very high. So coming back to making notes part, so there are certain common repetitive items that you will notice, usually some tool related or some external team related. So especially if you're doing an assessment for the first time, if you're just being with the team for the first couple of weeks, if you're going to start pairing with them, you will start noticing a lot of similarities. You know, make notes of it, because it is very crucial for you to get the big picture and give it back to them. Because these are things, even if you do a value stream exercise with the teams, I've noticed that these items never come up in the issues. Because they always talk about symptoms, and very rarely do people get into the real problems and start discussing about it. So that's what I mean by make notes, meaning it really helps, because sometimes what I do is I may not even tell the developer or the tester about what I have observed, but when I start pairing with different people, I get some collective idea about what is happening. Right? So now coming to what are the advantages, what are the tangibles? The very first tangible here is, you know, I feel it kind of removes the inhibition about pairing and pair programming if it is done right. Especially if you are being supportive, if you're friendly, people kind of get away with the inhibitions and they really don't mind pairing with you. I had this problem when I was working with a Chinese team because they had a lot of issues with working with their peer, meaning they were not very vocal about it. They're comfortable to work in their own cubicle and then just do whatever they have to do. So I started with pairing, started working with developers, sitting with them, and sometimes have some friendly chats, it doesn't matter. It's not like you have to always ask about work and what they are doing. Have some friendly banters and it really, really goes a long way. So that's the first part. And the second one is it sets the stage for the other practices because success is going to breed success. And like I said, it's going to help you visualize the value stream. Many things the team members don't even specify, but when you start pairing with them, you'll start noticing so many symptoms. And helps the coach understand individual concerns. I have always had this experience, every time I have a one-on-one or every time I sit with a team member, I hear more than what they would tell me otherwise in a team meeting. So interestingly, so I have to share something here. So I do some interventions and one-on-ones with the team members to understand what their concerns are. And if the team is dysfunctional, you know, meaning what I mean is if they are not very close in the team, if they are not working as a team to begin with, they have a lot of, you'll see a lot of patterns. So once I was pairing with the teams, and interestingly, every team member gave me something about their team. They said, this is not okay. This team member is not okay. It was just a very casual chat. And also what was very interesting is every team, single team member told me, don't tell anyone. You know, I have given you this input, but don't tell anyone. And this is a very easy situation for me, so this is where I'm talking about awareness. There are two ways for me to handle it. One way is I can just say, okay, I will not tell anyone, and I just move out of the room. So in the process, I might assume that I'm building trust. But if you say it is actually not the case. So what I usually do is, I intervene. I just put them on a spot. But try to be friendly about it, humorous about it, but I do tell them exactly what I have to say. In fact, in all the instances with every team member, I told them, if that is the case, what is the point in this conversation? So what I will do is I'll just tell them, okay, I will ask you to come into a room. I will not put you on the spot, but please do discuss about this issue. So be very, very watchful of what you are doing. That's what I mean by awareness. Because in these kind of arrangements and engagements, team members do tell you a lot of things which they wouldn't tell otherwise. Yeah? Creates a positive synergy, yes, and helps the coach see the real problem. So what I mean by real problems is you're not going to scratch the surface, you're not going to just look at the symptoms, you're going to look beyond that. All right, so I think I'm largely done. So finally, I just want to quickly talk about a few tools that I use which really helps me in the process as well. One of them is contracts, which I've said. Of course, group discussions and value stream maps. And two-chair techniques is something that I use when I have to resolve some conflicts in team members. Let's say if there are unspoken conflicts because of which if certain things are not happening, you can just Google for it. I'm not going to talk about this in this particular presentation. So that's two-chair technique for you. So these are very handy for me, but you guys can try and experiment. All right, so I think I'm done. So please don't judge me. I'm not endorsing drinking here. I just want to say wine doesn't judge me, neither should you. It's just a metaphor to say how it can be different. And just be free, you know, just be very playful about it. Just toy around with the whole idea. I had great fun doing this. I think I've done this for the past 8 to 9 months with like about 9 teams, and I had a really, really great time. So thank you so much. So if you have any questions, I'll just take them up now. Yes.
So you're going to pair up with different stakeholders
in
the team, right?
Yes.
What is this role called? What is this role called?
Okay, why do I have to have a name?
So how can you be part of the team and how can the team members trust you? Because you're going to pair up with different stakeholders. So how are you going to build up this trust? And it is a non-technical coach. So how can you get involved with the team? There has to be some role to play within the team to get engaged and work as a team. So this role is of, I don't know, what you will define this role as?
Okay, I mean, I'll say what my role was. Maybe that could be the answer. But I wouldn't say it is very role specific. It need not be a coach as well. I would think it can be anyone in the team who can carry on with this. But since I was a coach, I was doing it as a coach. There was a role specification, what was expected out of me. And there was a challenge as well. So it went on with this. So I just started pairing with different people, meaning what I do is actually a very crucial point that you made. How will they trust me if I'm going to start pairing with different stakeholders, right? That is a dysfunction.
So
And you got a point already there. So if it is not happening, that is a dysfunction. And the first thing that you have to fix is that, and not really about your technical practices. Just fix the trust part first, and eventually things will fall in place. There might be another problem that you might surface. So did I answer your question? Yeah. So any other questions? Yes. No, actually, I didn't measure the productivity at all, because unfortunately, all the engagements have been because it had various different geographical locations, it was for a short span. And the intent was also not that. The intent was mostly to see how well they take up pairing, how well they start pairing with each other. Because if you see, I don't know if you guys have this challenge, but even though we say we are doing agile, even though we say we are working as a team and all that, often I've noticed that team members work on individual tasks. They really don't go beyond that. So productivity I have not measured, sorry. No, I think I'm also getting late, I guess. Maybe one question and then I'll close.
Is distributed. Sure. Do you expect this to be in-person kind of a thing pairing, or it can be still remote? You can still connect to some of the stakeholders, not necessarily in the same location. Maybe in the same country, but another location.
So you're asking me if I can pair over phone?
Over the
telephone or something, or any telepresence?
All live in the same place.
See, I have tried doing with few teams in the US, but what I've realized is it's not very effective. Because here, what I'm really looking at is the actual problems and the real problems and the conversation, which doesn't happen through any of these virtual mediums. But nevertheless, if you don't have an option, probably you could try that. I have tried it as well, but I felt this is a lot more effective than this virtual means.
Thank you.
Yeah. Sure. So thank you very much. Thanks for your patience. So.